show reviewer and director of stylistic premonitions for the Universal Media Network with today's Arts Review.
Suddenly returns with a whole new look and feel. I give you, and please remain seated, Negative Land.
Finally, I told him to get into his room or else. town until you're ready for Sunday school, I firmly warrant. From the next room, I can hear my husband, Fred, screaming at our 8-year-old twin girls. I plop down on the new Davenport we had bought at Levitt's. But it brought little comfort as my eyes welled up with tears. As comical as it sounds, I'm sure all of you ladies know how it is. It wasn't but 2 minutes later that Stevie emerged. Mommy, he whined, I can't find my socks. That was the limit. I lunged from my seat, reaching for the stick that I kept on top of the refrigerator. Stevie bolted past me in an attempt to avoid discipline, but then, realizing he was cornered, attempted to escape once more. I grabbed at his shirt as he darted past, but I momentarily lost my balance and fell to the carpet. Stevie raced for the kitchen. I had begun preparing our Sunday dinner, a Virginia scrapple roast that I would serve cold after church, and the 5-pound pork butt was sitting in my deep fat fryer on the counter. In his willful frenzy, Stevie's arm caught the cord, dumping the entire kettle of boiling grease on his back and legs, ruining his new Sunday pants and severely burning his skin. Naturally, Stevie screamed loudly, bringing attention to himself from the whole family. The twins looked on in horror as I forced Stevie onto our older, tackier Davenport. He screamed and flailed as the beet red skin peeled from his little body. I washed off the fat and grease with a dish soapy sponge and water and rubbed on a coat of whipped salt butter from Aunt Carolyn's farm. Later, I learned that plain water would have been better, so next time I'll know. Stevie continued to scream, and Fred frequently peered in from the next room. There goes church, he complained, looking impatiently at the clock. Soon it became apparent that Stevie needed a doctor, so off we went in our Sunday best to the hospital emergency room. I agreed with Fred that the twins should not miss Sunday school and that I could tend to Stevie. As his screams echoed down the hall from the treatment room, I began to question my ability as a mother. Was spanking the best way to break Stevie's will? Was it worth all of this? I prayed that God would provide an answer. It was hours later when Stevie was released, bandaged from the neck down. As we arrived home, the twins pointed and laughed, calling Stevie a mummy. I told them to shush and that we didn't believe in those things. With our help, Stevie was in church an hour later, worshiping with us despite his discomfort. A miracle, I thought, though I still suffered with the pain of my own unanswered question, to spank or not to spank. I knew that I would need an answer quickly. That night, as scheduled, I began to change Stevie's dressings. They ripped at Stevie's inflamed raw skin, and he wailed and thrashed as my frustration grew. I opened my mouth to reprimand him, but was stopped short, as if the hand of God had come down to comfort me, and all went quiet. The answer was right before my eyes, and I stared motionless in amazement. Stevie's back and legs were badly burned, but his bare bottom was left completely unscarred and perfectly preserved. I became totally aware of the presence and of the power of God. Thank you, Jesus, I whispered. Thank you for answering me. Stevie started to wail. Stop it, I said, firmly slapping his behind. Praise God, I felt like a mother again. And in closing, please remember, before you ask yourself, ask others, what would Jesus do?
Inhale. Exhale. Re-inhale. Four, exhale. Continue this.
Day in and day out.
Inhale.
Day in and day out.
Two, exhale.
Day in and day out.
Three, inhale. Four, exhale.
Day in and day out.
Continue this.
We sort of breathe it in and we exhale it out.
Your muscles unwinding, becoming loose, like a wet dish rag.
Day in and day out.
Inhale.
Breathe it in.
Two, exhale.
And we exhale it out.
Three, inhale.
We
sort
of breathe it in.
Four, exhale.
Breathe in, breathe out.
Just do it.
Breathe in, breathe out.
Day in and day out.
We sort of breathe it in and we exhale it out.
Just do it.
Breathe in, breathe out. As.
Just do it.
Breathe in and day out.
Add feelings, add rhythms that are part of our lives in the most intimate ways. Breathe in, breathe out.
Day in and day out.
People do.
Ask.
Day in and day out.
Just do it.
Breathe in, breathe out.
People do.
Ask. Breathe in, breathe out.
Day in and day out.
It works.
Ask. Add feelings, add rhythm. Add feelings, add rhythm.
There is an enormous amount of research into the audience.
Add feelings, add rhythm.
It works.
Breathe in.
Achilles.
Breathe out.
Achilles.
Add feelings, add rhythm. Breathe in, breathe out.
There is an enormous amount of research.
Ask.
There is an enormous amount of research into the audience, and their anxieties, dreams, hopes, and aspirations are researched relentlessly and then repackaged and sold back. So they are part of a loop.
Add feelings, add rhythm. We sort of breathe it in and we exhale it out. As.
Back to life.
As. As.
A loop. A loop. And then it's really part of a loop.
Add feelings, add rhythm.
But can they really get inside my head?
As long as you keep an open mind.
I am one.
Breathe in, breathe out.
Hi, I'm me, and I'm using this to sell you this.
Breathe it in and we exhale it out. that are part of our lives in the most intimate ways.
So they are part of a loop.
Breathe in, breathe out.
Summer, my wife, her name is me. hopefully, we're going to compile it. It's going to be a positive reflection of what Pepsi's all about and the makers of their advertising. So I think it's fair to say that if that's all the case, this is part of the marketing side of Pepsi.
I got fired. I'm a boss. Pepsi.
Kids want to appear older. We don't want rowdy, street-looking kids, but we don't want Midwestern milk-fed-looking kids either. The kids should look mature, wise, and have character.
To package themselves?
We don't want redheads with freckles, all blonde, blue-eyed darlings. We want a cross-section of the American girl.
To package themselves? To package themselves and market themselves.
Some pretty, some not so pretty.
To package themselves and market themselves as shiny, attractive, cool, totally semi-awesome little packages that others are going to want to buy.
But with character. We want to portray the world the way it is, so we have to cover the ethnic requirements. Some blacks, some Latinos. This is not your typical McDonald's commercial. We are talking a daring step for McDonald's.
As shiny, attractive, cool, totally semi-awesome little packages.
The kids we are speaking to are dramatically sophisticated. The McDonald's objective between advertising is to portray happy, smiling kids in their own world.
Cool, totally semi-awesome little packages that others are going to want to buy.
The camera is like a disembodied spirit that catches these kids in the act of being themselves.
As shiny, attractive, cool, totally semi-awesome little packages.
McDonald's still represents God, America, and apple pie. They tell you they want to move out of the neighborhood. But then we find out that they only wanted to go next door.
Totally semi-awesome little packages that others are going to want to buy.
I'm saying this to say that there is a fine line between where we are and how far we can go. These spots should not look too urban, too ethnic, too new wave, or too anything.
To package themselves.
It doesn't jive with McDonald's image.
Package themselves.
Lighting should be dramatic, but not shadowy. Location should be beautiful, but not weird. Clothing should be contemporary, but not fun. Casting should be characterizations, but not to the point of kudos. In other words, we can go out of the ordinary, but we can't live there. I know this may sound confusing, but I find it's better to know the way McDonald's works now than argue on the set about it later. Good luck, everyone.
Two units, requiring your kissing up and hugging work. A certain way when you get into Contra Costa County. I'm feeling that way now, and I'm coming out of the tunnel on the east side. And we're in a Brenda now, isn't that nice? We're in a Brenda. And we're going to get off Highway 24, I believe, at the sign that says Rossmore. Oh boy, that's where I fixed the Playboy Channel for 8,000 senior citizens every day. Except today, of course, because I'm on my way to 180 in the letter G. So we take that Rossmore exit. And it looks like right now we're coming up to where everything is purple. Yep, we're passing that point now. That there are more universities. I had a service call there on the Playboy Channel one time. And of course the cable was all purple, but in the rooms, they got these little tiny rooms, and all there is a bed and a huge jar of Vaseline. So I got real frightened. I had to get out of there quick. So I took the cable box. I wasn't supposed to do that either, but I didn't want those people to get the Playboy Channel. Very, very bad. So forget about that now. I'm kind of afraid of that place. So I'm up to the sign that says on Hanford Avenue in Martinez, on our way to 180 on letter G. There's absolutely no other possibility. We have to get to 180 G. Okay, we're nearly there now. We're coming up to the place where, oh yes, there it is. Where the A&W Root Beer place used to be. It's not there anymore now. I think it's a Jiffy Lube. But on the other side of the street is another little place. It's Safe Muffins. And you know you're going to have to get into Safe Muffins and shoplift the HR steam cleaning system. Or you can go to Safe Muffins and shoplift the HR steam cleaning system. You have to become invisible. And you have to find a little Martinez sewer gas. There's a manhole cover right there at G and Alhambra. You stand on the green dot on the manhole cover. I don't know why there's a green dot on it, but that's what you have to do. Nevertheless, become invisible. You let that sewer gas come all over your body. Then we're going to become invisible. Oh, yeah. We're becoming invisible now. What? I'm just floating. I'm invisible now. That's it. I'm going in to Save Muffins. No one can see a damn thing. They might see the steam machine moving all by itself, but that's just dumb old me shoplifting it, because somewhere somebody knows that I have to get it up to G. So I've successfully done that now. I've got the steam cleaning system. I'm wheeling it up G Street. It actually is a street. It's G Street. But I'm going to just keep calling it G. Or was it the numeral 2 and the letter U? You know, I thought about that all of a sudden. That's odd. But I'm going to just keep calling it G. So we're just about up there now. It's the hill is real steep. I'm having trouble with this goddamn cleaner. Whoops, there goes the carpet wand. I gotta get that back, and it fell off. Let me go pick it up. Okay. I've got it in my hand again. I'm coming up to 180 and the letter G. It's funny how G and 180 are like the same thing. Actually, it isn't. They're two separate things. I'm up at 180. And it's a little blue place, I guess. And you march right up the steps. And you push the button. The door opens automatically. And you see the dog juice. The horrible dog juice all over the orange carpet. And you know right then you're going to have to take care of all that dog juice with the HR steam cleaning system. And you just realized that you got it all over your hand on the doorknob. There's dog juice on the doorknob as well. So you march right into 180 and the letter G. And you hear a voice. and it says, Drew, fetch my cigarettes. Another voice says, they're on top of the refrigerator. But you don't let that bother you. You're inside now, and you know you have to complete your mission. So you go back to the kitchen. And you notice the Mr. Coffee coffee maker has your hot water ready to pour into your HR steam cleaning system. You're getting really excited now because you know you're going to be able to take care of the dog juice. So I'm ready now to pour the hot water into the HR steam cleaning system along with a little super concentrated rug cleaner. Not a thimbleful is all it takes for a whole gallon of water. It really does a good job. So there we go. You've got your HR steam cleaning system all fired up. And you take care of all the dog juice in the living room on the orange carpet. And it's going along real good. And you just all of a sudden realize that you have to go into the basement when you're done. You don't know why you have to go in, but you know there are toads in the basement. Believe it or not, there's 180 of them. Western toads, males and females, in the basement. Start up, and they see no one driving. I heard that before, no one driving, but I'll be visible again maybe by the time I get to the train trestle. But I've got to get back to San Francisco. I've done my job of 180G. And I have to go in reverse gear all the way back to San Francisco now, using my rear view mirror. I can see my little ham radio repeater station's red lights flashing as I whisk into the tunnel. And it's still real hot. But then, about halfway through, I stop feeling a certain way. I'm getting out of Contra Costa. I can sense it. I don't know why I stop feeling a certain way, but I just do. And I'm about halfway through, and I come out, and I'm back to normal again, on the other side, away from Contra Costa County in 180 and Litter G. Oh, and I won't see it. I can see across, but there's fog. It's fog, real odd. It's staying high all the time. I think I'm going to get into it, but the fog always stays so damn high in California. But I'm getting lower from the fog. I give up on that. To heck with the fog. I'm passing K101 now, big chairs. Also forget, turn on the AM radio, get it to K101 quick. I want to get that radio frequency energy. Ooh, there it is. Right there, the big chairs passing by on the south side. All that distortion. Think they're playing the village people. Oh, the story, but it sounds so good. I'm on the bridge now. And here I am. There's going to be an absolutely no other possibility somewhere thrown in here. I'm starting to get that feeling now. Oops, there's the place where the sex chemical blew up. There we are. We're on that big turn again. That was so great. I think I might have seen it on the Channel 4 news with Art Brown. I think it was on all the channels that I had there. did they have practical comfort back then? I don't know. But all people started getting real sexy, and some of the people crashed in their cars. I guess they had an orgasm or something as a sex chemical engulfing the freeway. But I'm past that now. I'm down. I'm getting off. Still going backwards. Still looking in my rearview mirror. There's like, I guess, my third street or fourth street, the entrance to my sewer pipe back here in San Francisco. And here I am. There's my sewer pipe. I'm going into the pipe now, lifting up this grill, and in I go. So here I am. It's kind of a tight squeeze in here. There's a lot of slime, but it's really starting to feel good. I'm getting deep within my sewer pipes now. I never want to go out to Contra Costa County again after I get in here. I always feel that way. I never, ever want to go back out to 180 on a letter tube in Contra Costa County ever again. I think we're just about getting to that point where it's going to be 10-7. I'm just about there now. No, I'm here. This must be where all the toilets from the Transamerica Pyramid empty out. All these little pipes emptying out into this big room here. Guess I'm 150 feet under the streets of San Francisco. It's just so great in here. It's just really good. And it's time now. We're getting to that point just about right now. I think here it is. We're 10-7. Out! Is that it or what? I don't know. Do you want to Google it, your prune or something, or what?
Dun 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 dun. What's music?
Oh,
sway.
But you're not loud enough. You're not fast enough. Rhythm's still off. Still misses the beat.
What's music?
Music I listen to what I am? Exactly.
What's music?
Up in the air. surface noise or deterioration of vinyl records and real realism of digital sound.
And the raindrops
party with an old sailor. And all the rest of them on the Christmas tree, and they're pretty cool to get a sailor. That's all I remember. I know there's about three verses, so I can't remember the rest.
What kind of barnacles are they?
trip me out again. This is the first time I've taken LSD in years. Yes, that's the last thing I heard after coming out from backstage. Backstage is a very worldly place. Lots of smoking, drinking, smut written all over the walls. Some of the most off-color jokes I've heard since I got out of the Coast Guard. I did hear a good one, though, that I can't tell here. It's a riddle, actually. Let's see if you can get it. What do you get when you put your fingers into President Johnson's ears?
Radio!
Give up?
More!
You get President Johnson's wax. Last month, I was blessed with the privilege of teaming up with renowned gospel artist Hal Kiakoia, better known as the Hallelujah Hawaiian. Now, over the last 20 years or so, Hal has released 37 gospel albums full of reworked Christian favorites, offering the believer an alternative to the secular Hawaiian music. And Hal and I were the guests of honor at Women's Retreat at Mount Hermon. And Women's Retreat is a celebration of the family, really. It's where we men speak to the women about how they can best glorify the Lord by glorifying their family. Or at least certain members of it, right, guys? But Hal had a great testimony. And I'm sure those of you who've listened to such radio programs as Focus on the Family and the Back to the Bible broadcast have heard Hal's testimony. Hal speaks a lot about the seamier side of the Hawaiian music industry. Now, you may have heard that a good share of the Hawaiian music is inspired by nitrous oxide. Or the Hawaiian punch, as it's referred to in the biz. And many of these Hawaiian songwriters and composers utilize the nitrous oxide. And many of you may know that nitrous oxide goes directly to work on the part of the brain called the cerebral cortex. And recently, a lot of the Christian scientists, well, not that kind of Christian scientists, you know what I mean, but scientific Christians have found that there's a direct link between the cerebral cortex and morality. So, is it any wonder that Hawaii has been the first state to turn its back and launch an attack on traditional Christian values? Values that were put in place by our founding fathers, our original moral leaders, George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Abraham Lincoln, Ronald Reagan. Hal came to the Lord in 1970, and his autobiography, Under My Palm Hula Lulau, was released in 1985, but even today, it is very worthwhile reading. It's one of those books that you just can't pick up with and look at. I guess you can pick up any passage and you'll be spiritually enriched just by looking at the words. And I think I'm going to do that right now. Oh, yes. Here's a good passage. This is Hal speaking. I left my hotel just before sunrise, my tired body calling out for that nitrous rush. Entering the local market, I grabbed a basket and headed for the dairy case. My heart began to pound as my eyes looked onto the neat, rows of bargain brand aerosol non-dairy whip before me. Without thinking, I dropped my basket and swept up as many cans of the hydrogenated industrial compound as I could carry, and made a beeline for the checkout stand. The beautiful young cashier greeted me with a warm smile. I studied her closely as she rang up my purchase. She looked vaguely familiar to me. In the course of conversation, it became clear as to why, for the young brown-skinned native was none other than Constance Kiyoegi, the former hula queen and pitch girl for Shell Gasoline's Hula Dollars campaign. I quietly blushed in shame as I recalled the deviant fantasies I had conjured up after viewing these racy promotional ads. As she began bagging my excessive purchase, she jarred me out of my semi-stupor with the inquiry I dreaded the most. What are you going to do with all that whipped cream? In order to save face, I fibbed that I would use it as a topping for my famous Belgian waffles. Now this followed a night of intense snorting, and my post-nitrous fog was beginning to lead me into a cycle of poor decision-making. You see, despite the fact that the only waffles I'd ever dished up were from my toaster, I somehow ended up with a breakfast date. Belgian waffles. At my place in an hour. Thank God I blasphemed in vain to myself for room service. In my sinister mind, I plotted how I would skate through this ordeal and jump this unsuspecting checker to indulge myself in acts of shameful fornication. Little did I know that Constance had recently come to the Lord and had other plans for me. When the big moment arrived and Constance entered my door, the waffles were ready, awaiting their foamy garnishment. I excused myself and turned to retrieve a fresh can of whip from the refrigerator. Constance, both eager and helpful, grabbed the spent can I had left on the counter during the previous night's binge and went to work. When I turned around, the waffles were covered with a runny veil of creamy glop. Constance looked me in the eye knowingly. I had been found out. Well, we'll stop there because we don't have time to go over what happened in that luxurious hotel room that day. But I do have time to tell you that Hal fell to his knees before the Lord and was immediately delivered from noxious propellants. And we can thank one little Hawaiian girl and the fine folks at Shell Gasoline for Hal's conversion. You know, it's deep caring and love for the undeserving that separates the believer from the non-believer. And who else but a God-fearing believer could so meticulously separate the sinner from the sin? Who else but a Bible-believing Christian could so love the sinner and hate their sin and care enough to tell them so? Which brings us to the next portion of our show. As you know, it's vacation Bible school time. Well, it's right around the corner anyway. And our puppet ministry from Faith Fellowship is joining us here this evening. And they're stepping out of character to present their message of love and caring for all of you here this evening. Now, turning to our first guest, he's a veteran announcer and broadcaster. He's been my personal announcer on Ask Pastor Dick since 1981. You know him as the alert and unbending Mr. Dale Embry. Sure, a lot of our audience tonight knew you were a recovering homosexual, but I don't think many of them realized you were a squirrel.
That's right, Pastor Dick. You know, nowadays more and more people say to me,
Dale, Christianity is stupid. Communism is good. Give up. But you know, I don't believe that. In fact, I love Christianity, for I am a Christian. How fortunate I am to reflect on a spiritually centered childhood. When I look back, I see flannel graph, not fights. I hear fellowship, not funk. I taste pot roast, not pills. For following kids' brigade, not kidnappers. All because my mean parents would not let me have my way. Now, as I look forward to raising a family of my own, I'll feel proud when my children call me mean.
Well, that's very, very moving, Dale, and I thank you for that. Now, I understand you have some friends with you tonight, and what better opportunity to show off your announcing skills but to introduce all of our
new... Thank you, Pastor Dick. Now, here's our first guest. He's a frequent co-sponsor of Promise Keepers of Poopiston, Illinois, and you may recognize him as a semi-regular on Calvary's Treehouse. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Chuck Mueller.
Yeehaw! What kind of a freak show is this? Do I detect a bit of blasphemy in the air tonight?
Oh, well, Chuck, now I think it's just because our audience...
Our next guest is just like each and every one of us here this evening. A little lost lamb who has gone astray. As insignificant and unworthy as the fallen sparrow. So dumb and blind is she, pitifully paralyzed by her own fear, that we can't hear the screams as she is trampled mercilessly by an angry pen of bulls. Will you please welcome Miss Nadine Lambert.
Well, don't just stand there. What do you have to say for yourself?
Oh, I don't like it here. I'm afraid.
Oh, Nadine, now, what are you afraid of?
Oh, the big crowd of people.
Oh. Huh. If you want to know the truth, we're not even sure they even are people.
Now, Chuck, our audience can't help what they look like.
Well, actually, Pastor Dick, our audience probably could help it. But I believe they've deliberately altered their appearance as a lifestyle choice.
Oh, I'm really scared.
Oh, for corn's sakes, we can always slam the barn doors if we're attacked.
Oh, Chuck, now please.
But that's not what I'm afraid of.
Well, just what is it you're afraid of, Nadine?
I don't think they're saved.
Well, Nadine, now we have no way of knowing whether our audience is saved.
Pastor Dick, I know how we can find out for sure.
How's that, Dale?
Come a little closer, and I'll tell you.
Oh, that's a great idea, Dale, but we'll need our audience to help us out. As the saying goes, saving everybody.
If you're saved, then you know it's amen.
Amen.
If you're saved, then you know it's amen.
Amen.
If you're saved, then you know it, then your life will surely show it. If you're saved, then you know it's amen.
Amen.
There you see.
Good luck, everybody.
about that.
They look like a bunch of harlots, if you ask me.
Oh, Chuck, now you stop that. Now be a good witness.
Okay. From here on out, I'll be a good witness.
Well, that's much better. Thank you, Chuck.
And I can't believe what I'm witnessing.
Chuck, please.
Oh, don't be bad. Let's sing a song.
Oh, all right. But I'm sure they'll hate it. Hey, maybe this won't be so bad after all.
Take it, Dale.
Now, Pastor Dick presents his latest musical ministry as inspired through the pages of the Bible.
Let's all put our hands together and pray for a better world. I don't believe in problems, I believe in right and wrong. And it's clear to me that each of us should be where we belong. But many people out there behave like simple fools, living how they want to live while we obey the rules. If everyone cleaned up their act and everything would shine, everyone would be like us, we'd be with our own kind. Life would be much easier if they knew false were true. Then they could love their fellow man exactly like I do. Dale, why don't you speak what's on your mind?
I believe that alcoholics should give up their right to drink, and those without their marbles deny the right to think.
Sounds reasonable.
I'm sure all homosexuals could make themselves go straight. If all the hippies cut their hair, I'd have no one to hate.
There'd be nothing left but love.
If everyone cleaned up their act and everything would shine, everyone would be like us, we'd be with our old kind. Life would be much easier if they knew false from true. Then they could love their fellow man exactly like I do.
Chuck, why don't you tell us what we want to hear?
The unemployed should get a job, there's lots of them out there. Then they'd be wearing cleaner clothes and wouldn't have to care.
They'd have cleaner sheets too.
And if everyone believed in God and prayed to Him each day, then drugs and sex and cigarettes would surely go away.
Our spirits would sparkle.
If everyone cleaned up their act and everything would shine, everyone would be like us, we'd be with our own kind. Life would be much easier if they would fall from truth. Then they could love their fellow man exactly like I do.
Over that stage fright, Nadine.
We could lock up all the criminals and confiscate their guns and use them to hunt deer and elk, teach our growing sons.
Everyone cleaned up their act and everything would shine. Everyone would be like us, we'd be with our own kind. Life would be much easier if they knew false from true. Then they could love their fellow man exactly like I do.
May love, compassion, and empathy follow you wherever you are, or
Amen.
Whatever you are. Good night.
Oh,
true or false.
Trying to present the truth.
Same idea.
The fire across town, the freeway pilot, the hijacked airline, and the latest earthquake, the bank robbery downtown, and yet another communist threat to the free world.
What you will report on this program will be biased towards some little view or another. It depends on whose slice of the tape team you sound on.
It's not the tool!
Besides on which sound bites to use.
Real computer craze, dance craze, fashion craze, food craze, diet craze, doll craze, video game craze, pro craze, culture dips. And of course, the latest craze, killer.
The more childish you are, the more dangerous you think the world is.
Everyone already knows about starving Africans, or nothing can be done about it anyway.
Losing their bearings. We don't know what's important, what's television and satellite and all that business. Then we are simply silly anymore.
Drama, comedy, life's parade at your fingertips.
First of all, I thought it was nobody's business. Ms. Lewinsky was asked and said that neither of these statements was untrue.
That was true. I know and knew nothing of sexual harassment.
And also that there was truth to both of these statements.
Greetings for the white and gold can with a long, funny name that's greasy.
We have repeatedly reminded this body of these plain and simple words with their plain, simple, and exculpatory meaning.
President said something. You could always say you were coming in to see Betty or bring me papers.
What did you understand you would be saying in that affidavit to avoid testifying?
In the best of my recollection, it was, to my mind, it was a range of things. I mean, it could either be something innocuous or could go as far as having to deny the relationship.
Did you understand that you would deny your relationship with the president to Jones Walker, who usually is counseling?
From what I learned in that conversation, I thought to myself, I knew I would deny the relationship.
And you would deny the relationship to the Jones Walker?
Yes. If that's what it came to.
And in fact, you did deny the relationship to the Jones Waters in the affidavit that you signed under penalty of perjury. That's right.
I denied a sexual relationship.
Can you sit back as the President of the United States after you told a lie to a key aide where you portray yourself as a victim and watch the press stories fall about or roll out along the lines that she wears her dress is too tight. She comes from a broken home. She's a stalker. She's sex obsessed. Can you sit back and watch all that happen and still be truthful but misleading?
True or false?
He gave you some gift that day, and my question to you is, what went through your mind when you did that? When you knew all along she had just received a subpoena to produce you, is that not concerning?
No, I was happy to get them. I think, at that moment, when you asked me when he gave me those gifts, so at that moment when I was there, I was happy to be with him, I was happy to get these Christmas presents, so, and that very brief exchange is the heart of the case. I think so.
True or false?
First of all, I thought it was nobody's business. Through this proceeding, the managers have consistently told you how credible a witness Ms. Lewinsky is. But carefully, only in snippets, only when it suits their purposes.
True or false?
Yes.
sorting table from Pat.
It's a storm of lies.
Sorting table from Pat.
It's a storm of lies. A blizzard of lies. A hurricane of lies you're living in every day.
Sorting table from Pat has undoubtedly been a problem to man since he first began to speak.
I think that a discernment is very necessary here. A discernment is very necessary here. And we need a discernment. And we need, a discernment is very necessary here. I find this intriguing. I don't believe it. Intriguing. I don't believe it necessarily. You can tell if it's true or not true. You don't have enough data. You can tell if it's true or not true. You don't have enough data. I think data is very necessary here. Where were we and where have we gotten to? Because you go over here, want this show over to you. You go over here, you want this? Sure, no problem. And you go over here, want this show over to you. You go over here, you want this? Sure, no problem. We'll manufacture a whole smorgasbord of these notes for the same purpose, or they are linking us up on the same inner dynamics, yearnings, and needs on a deep psychological level. Sure, no problem. We'll manufacture a whole smorgasbord. Sure, no problem. Where have we gotten to because of someone's manipulation of us? Okay, so here, but that might be threatening. I think that would also be threatening. Discern is mystery.
What truth is in the listeners, truth is in the end all that matters.
I don't think anything can be
worse. I don't think anything can be worse than that.
I think it's a great question.
Perception is the reality.
You want to come up with this, and just get buttons that are being pushed.
Which goes on forever. There are always statements
that can be neither proved nor disproved. This statement is true. Let's just think about this statement for a minute. If the statement is true, then the statement is false. And if the statement is false, then the statement is true. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. If the statement is false, then the statement is true. And if the statement is true, then the statement is false. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. If the statement is true, then the statement is true. And if the statement is false, then the false statement is true. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. If I say to you, this true statement is false. Let's just think about this statement for a minute. If I say to you, if this true statement is false, then the statement is false. And if the false statement is false, then the statement is true. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. If the false statement is true, then the statement is true. Just think about this statement for a minute. And if the true statement is false, then statement is false. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. If the true statement is false, then statement is true. And if the statement is true, and if it's false, then statement is true. False. False. Forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. Just think about the statement for a minute. If the statement is true, and if the statement is false, then there's no way we can ever show that the statement is either true or false. This statement is false. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. If the statement is forever, then forever is the statement. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. Which goes on forever. Which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. Which goes on forever. Which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever. And we get into a loop which goes on forever.
Thank you. which goes on forever, and the game which goes on forever, and which goes on forever, which goes on forever, and the game which goes on forever, which goes on forever, which goes on forever.
Just as it is now, which is the infinite
digital, which goes on forever, and the getting to a loop, which goes on forever, and the getting to a loop, which goes on forever, and the getting to a loop, which goes on forever, and the getting to a loop, which goes on forever, and the getting to a loop, which goes on forever.
A simple, honest yes or no, or true or false. A simple, honest yes or no, or true or false. A simple, honest yes or no, or true or false.
True or false?
Your coffee, your Coca-Cola, we just ain't gonna do it no more.
Another one of those jokes.
Are some of you old enough to remember what these things are?
Oh, yeah.
See, we're very well known for using cutting-edge technology.
Ready?
Okay. Well, good evening, and thanks a lot for coming. For our final piece this evening, we'd like to invite you all to read along with us by following the big words up here on the big screen.
Yeah.
out.
Thank you.
No, thank you.